Ladies and gentlemen, participants, wherever you are, good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you are around the world. I would like to welcome you in the second day of our workshop, Introduction to Road Safety Audits. Yesterday, we had the first session where we introduced road safety audits, their requirements, definitions, concepts, as well as processes to be conducted through road safety audits. Today, our colleague Miguel Santos will continue this workshop by concentrating on most frequently observed road safety problems through audits and presenting also different experiences from around the world. Today, we will have only a 2-hour session starting from now until 7 p.m. Doha time. And it will concentrate on a lot of practical experience, practical examples about road safety issues that can be identified through road safety audits, inspections, or inspections. Please bear with us at the end of this session today. We will have, again, sharing our questionnaire, which we have announced yesterday. A lot of you, I believe, have filled it, but few still did not fill, so we will share it again for 5 minutes of your time for those who did not fill the questionnaire. For now, I wish you all the best on this session, and wish you a fruitful, enjoyable session with Miguel, and we are looking forward to get your questions in the Q&A bar in your screen. And of course, as a default setting for this webinar, you will be muted and the video will be off, but you can always send us your questions and we can summarize them at the end and hopefully have a couple of them to be answered during the discussion at the end. Thank you all, and I will give the floor to Miguel. Miguel, the floor is yours. I will share the screen and give you the remote control so that you can take over.
Thank you very much, Dr. Wael. Fantastic. Good introduction, like always. Okay. Hello, everybody. Hopefully you can hear me. Today we are having only a 2 hours training. That's very bad. 2 hours, I'm not even warm in my throat. Okay. But Dr. Wael and Susana, they said, oh, Miguel, don't talk too much. Yesterday, the people, they were nearly dead because you talk too much. So today I said, well, I'm going to become a little bit better. And Dr. Wael, I need to control your, that's it, perfect. Let me see. I got that one. So Dr. Wael and Susana, they told me not to make this session very bad, very long. And talking a lot. So the thing that we will do today is to enjoy and see many examples from many parts of the world. And of course, we are going to see how we can improve the designs that we got through the road safety audits. So yesterday, when I was doing that, I was already explaining which are the most common answers and problems that we find in the road safety audits. And I put for every different stage of the road safety audit, I put everything in the way that it could be found. Today, we are going to go to the examples. Let's put the foot on the ground and let's continue. Okay. Dr. Wael. Okay, let me see. It's in a slide presentation because I cannot pass. Let me see.
Dear Miguel, can you just move using the arrows, please? Do not touch the
Yes, I'm doing that. I'm doing that.
Yes. Now I give you again the
remote. Don't worry. Yes, it's in a slide mode?
Yes.
Okay, let me see. It's not working. Don't start again with this. It was working 10 minutes ago, I swear to God. Okay, we were doing the test and everything was fine. Ay. Mm-hmm. No stress. Jose, that's fantastic, but the stress is always with me. That's my surname. Serrano Stress Santos.
Can you see the screen now?
Yeah, yes, put it for me to control it. I do it from here. Let me see.
Get in full slide mode.
Now it's full slides, yes.
Now you have the control.
Let me see. No, I don't have the control. Dr. Well, can you go back one moment, please? Just one moment. Go to the, not to the slide mode. Go to the normal mode. That's it. Leave it in there. Now pass me the control, please. Okay, let me see. Yes, I got it in here. Let me see. If I can switch off this, perfect. One moment. I'm going to put the slide mode now. Insert design transitions. Yes. Because I cannot go to the bottom of this. Now. Okay.
Maybe you can just.
Please,
move.
Nobody.
Without slide mode, can you just go down?
No. I got it. One moment. Let me see. Here. Okay. Let me see. Ah, I'm controlling now. Yoo-hoo! Okay, no problem. Well, so today, the thing that I said is that we are going to be taking examples from everywhere in the world. Of course, we're going to take a sample first from the place that I am. Okay, that is in Qatar now. And I put that sentence yesterday and I put it again because someone was asking me yesterday a question that I was not able to illustrate, okay? So I said, complying with the standard does not guarantee road safety. So let's talk about this. This is the example that I tried to put yesterday, okay? We got this kind of road where we can see very clear that if you want to turn to the right, okay, in here, Dr. Well, please don't use your mobile, your mouse. Okay. If this car is going to turn on the right hand side, okay, you can have a rear shunt collision with the vehicles that they are coming. This car, when it's trying to go from the minor road to the main one, it has full visibility. So this is good. This is a good design. That is not a problem. However, someone can say, hey, I know how can we reduce the accident in here, the rear shunt collision. Let's prepare a deceleration road for them. Dr. Well, you have, I cannot control again. I think it's true what you said, that as soon as you got the, as you touch your mouse, I lose the control. Okay, let me one moment. What do you think, Druba? Is a right-hand drive or a left-hand drive? What do you think? Come on, cannot you see the front of the cars? Ay, oh my God. Okay, so when you create this deceleration road, you are obviously avoiding the rear shunt collision, okay? But you can have another problem that you have that you didn't have before. That is, the people that they are exiting from the minor road, they are going to be obstructing their visibility because the people they are occupying now that right turning, that filter that we have put, okay, the deceleration lane. So this is why you are complying with the standard. You are trying to do your best in order to remove one kind of accident that we got in here. But you are provoking another situation, okay, that it may result in other kind of accident, okay? So how can we sort it out? Well, it's very simple. You put that kind of ghost island or island in there, and in that way, you can channelize the traffic in a safe manner without any problem in order that they're not going to have reaction collision. And the people that they're exiting from the minor road, they are going still having full visibility to both sides. Okay? So you can see that in this case that we were here, you are complying with the standards, okay? But it's not always safety. The people, when they are designing roads, okay, they comply with the standard, but that it doesn't guarantee that the road is going to be safe, full safe, okay, for everybody. So what we are going to do in this session is that we have many problems, okay, that they are repeating in every single project that we see. I know that I have put in here that it's not a lack of knowledge of the standard because we suppose the professionalism of every single engineer that we are working with. However, it's a lack of knowledge about the safe system that we got here in Qatar. Okay, in more particularly part 23 and 24, QHDM 2015. Forget it. This is obsolete. This presentation is rubbish now because we already got a new QHDM from 2021 that I need to update this presentation for that one, okay? So let's see how are we going to illustrate the improvement of the design, taking into consideration the road safety auditor, what a road safety auditor will comment on it, okay? Let's start with pedestrian crossings. You remember one of the four questions that we put yesterday for the safe system, it was, can I extract a pedestrian at 30 kilometers per hour or more? Why? Because if you extract at more than 30 kilometers per hour, the chances to have a seriously injured or kill is very high, okay? So it is a normal practice that when we are having a junction, okay, we provide a great pedestrian crossing. That we are not always doing, you know, separate pedestrian bridges in order, pedestrian crossing with a bridge in order that they can cross in a safe manner. The normal thing is that they cross at the same status, a grade that the vehicles, okay? And sometimes the designers, they don't have information about the level of service for pedestrians or where are the desired lines of crossing for the pedestrian. Well, without that kind of information, it's very difficult, very, very difficult to assess what is the perfect pedestrian crossing that we need to do. But we can use our engineer's skill or the common sense, okay, that they are going to allow us to have a design in a very reasonable supposition. Please pay attention to the next slide that we're going to see in here, and you can tell me what you see. How can we improve it? Okay? So, look at this example. Okay? It's a humongous, a great crossing. Okay? If you realize, we got three lanes to cross. Look at the distance that the pedestrian is going to be crossing. Three lanes in only one direction, eh? Okay, and it's a grade. Let's continue looking at the pedestrian crossing. And look, it's even longer than you expect. But the thing that is quite funny is this one. The pedestrian crossing is coming through here, is going to the median where we got the grass, but why it doesn't come in here where we have put the paving? Okay? Very good. So in here, we are not giving any continuity to the pedestrian crossing that they are in here. Of course, just to have it like that, like a zebra crossing, three lanes, you cannot put it without any kind of control. Okay? So a road safety auditor will indicate, hey, where is the continuation of the pedestrian crossing in both of the sides? Are you sure that it's safe for a pedestrian to stay so long on the road in a zebra crossing? Okay. Look at this one. This is the other side of the pedestrian crossing. So in this pedestrian crossing in particular, okay, I think all of you that you are from Doha or from Qatar know the area, because it's very distinctive, the kind of light that we got in here, so you will know where we are, okay? So we continue, and look at this. We got the same length that we have, but in here, the pedestrian stop, okay? And they stop because they like to train for the Olympics and start doing long jump, okay? Or they are going to have a Red Bull, and Red Bull gives you wings, and you can fly. So the pedestrian is left in the middle of the road with no indication of what to do. Okay? So this kind of situation, this one, and this one that we are having here, the continuation, is not acceptable. We are going to have that kind of discontinuity in the pedestrian path that it can lead that the pedestrian become completely unaware about the risk that they are passing by. Okay? Which are the normal findings that we're going to find in places like that? Well, someone has written in there drop curbs, okay? We don't have any drop curve, it hasn't been provided. Vertical signs, have you seen any vertical signs saying, oh, I need to pass by from here, this is my area, I got priority, no pedestrian sign, okay? The road markings, you have seen that there are conflicting road markings. One for defect, because you don't have the road markings that they go until the end, in the case of the pedestrian crossing. But if you go to the previous picture, you can see that there is also conflict with the road markings that you got for the cars. So they haven't deleted properly, they haven't removed it properly, the road markings that they have from the temporary areas, from the war zone areas, okay? Tactile paving. Have you seen the tactile paving? And tactile paving is not considered the verge, the green grass that we got in there, okay? That is not tactile, okay? So there is no tactile paving that allow us to indicate for people that they got disabilities in the eyesight in order they can cross from there. The central island, as I said, they are guiding you directly where you got the grass, but not where it's paved in order that they can pass. Illumination. Any illumination? Have you seen the length that the pedestrian they need to cross? And imagine that during the dark. So it's not possible to see it, okay? Now, a big question. Are we going to use a raised table or a road hump in that position in order that the people, they are going to be safer crossing? Well, never. In this situation, when we are crossing two lanes or more in one direction of the traffic, we never use raised table or road hump. We need to put a signal control with a push button, okay? It's a must. We cannot leave to the generosity of the people that they are driving that the pedestrian they can cross in there, okay? Everything is not going to be bad. In fact, we got places where we got the people that they got the traffic signal, that they got an intermediate island, small, but it's an intermediate island, where they got the push button and everything signalized. So why such a difference? What happened? That the designers from one side, they are better than from the other side? That they don't know how to design? One study a little bit longer during the night, and they know how to do their projects a little bit better than the other ones, okay? Look at this one. As I said, two or more lanes in one direction, but in here we got two lanes, one in each direction. So we have put our race table in order to maximize that the people, they can cross in a safe manner. Local road, speed table, priority to the pedestrian. So in that way, everything is fine. Okay, I'm not going to go beyond with the fence that we offer for pedestrian or the bollards that we got in the middle, because the bollards, we put it the same in other countries in the world. We got very educated drivers that if they can park on the footpath, they will do it. This is why you need to put the bollards, okay? So another one. This is an example of an audit stage 3, okay? The detailed design that we were talking, okay? In here, the thing that I'm going to have into consideration for yourselves is the filters that we go for the right-hand side, okay? It's not recommended that we filter two lanes, okay, on the right-hand side. Because normally in here, unless that is signal control, that some of them they are not and some of them they are, if they are not signal control, it's one of the most dangerous things for pedestrians, okay? Exactly, this is only one lane, that is not a problem. The people, they can give way to the pedestrian, but the one that we got in here, that one that I had just pointed, that is very dangerous to have it like that. And also, how are you merging later? Okay, how? You are going to have something that we call trap lanes, and we don't want trap lanes in our design, okay? So This is the example that I was talking before, something that is good, local roads, okay? But look, in here, you have, as I said before, this is only one lane, is coming directly from a bend, and there is no rise table, as you have seen in here before. In the previous one, pedestrian, one lane in each direction, rise table, no problem. In here, if you realize, there is no traffic signal control, there is no rise table, there is not even a road hump in front of it, no rumble strips, nothing, no treatment. So how are you going to be dealing with that? Let me show you another angle. Look, the bend that you got is quite sharp. And because of the wall that you got in here made of concrete, this one, your visibility is compromised, okay? So a designer should be aware about this restraint, this constraint that we got. Yeah, they have done the drop curve. Yoo-hoo, very good, fantastic. But it's very good that we are going to start feeling confident to cross in here that someone at a speed of 50 kilometers per hour to negotiate, or 40 kilometers per hour to negotiate the one, they will be take the hit on the pedestrians that we are crossing. Okay. Yes, as I said, that is the kind of things that we can see, and the visibility beyond that point is compromised. Okay. Okay, let's answer another of the questions that we got in the safe system. Let's have a collision at 40 kilometers per hour or more with something that is not frangible, or furniture that we got on the side of the road, okay? It can cause kill or a seriously injure. Have a look to the picture that you got. Any lamp poles, any bollard that we put in there is going to be considered a hazard, any tree, any palm, okay? So we do not, as auditors, we don't need to check for the posted speed. We should check for the operational speed, okay? And we need to put in place, or we need to recommend, physical ways to eliminate or mitigate the risk. But physical ways that they are achievable, okay? That they can tell you, no, that is not possible, that is very expensive. No. Let's go to our engineering staff, okay? And we will provide the designers certain options. At the end, the people that they are going to take the decisions, they are the designer. We are just there to give a recommendation. We cannot be the ones selecting the things that they are going to be put on site, okay? So, again, we continue with this one. This is a local road, dual carriageway. We got a mini medium with a curb that is 14 millimeters, okay? And as you can see, is there anything that we can crash at 40 kilometers per hour or more? Well, people, they say, no, I got the lamp pole, but the lamp poles, they are protected because they are close to a curb. Wrong. Even this curb is the one that we consider non-mountable. At 50 kilometers per hour, any car can pass this kind of curb without any problem. And you can have a serious collision with all the lamp poles that you are having in here. Okay? In fact, I'm not saying this now, but you can even have a serious collision if you pass this one and you don't hit the pole. You can hit any kind of car that is coming in the opposite direction, creating for you a head-on collision. Okay? Look at this one. This, another one. This in here, this is a collector road close to the, what is the name? The North Road, okay? This is one of the collector roads. In here, I think the maximum speed is 60. Okay, when I was there, it was 80, but I think it has been dropped to 60. At 60 kilometers per hour in that road, are you serious? Do you see where the alignment of the road finish? Is finished beyond the horizon? Everything is straight? How are you going to keep the people at 60 here? Oh, yes, I'm going to put cameras, enforcement, in a collector road, speed cameras? That is not going to happen. So designer, they should be careful the way that they design collector roads in order to mitigate the risk that they are going to create for a wrong design. Look at this one. You are having in here a sign that is saying pedestrian crossing, but the pedestrian crossing two lanes, having into consideration that they are not going to respect the 60 kilometers per hour, that the people in here will go 80 to 90 because the alignment that they have put in here, how are you going to dare to cross this one at 80 or 90 kilometers per hour, vehicle passing by close to you? Oh, I love this one. This I told you yesterday when we were talking about the street furniture or the beauty of putting big stones in the middle of the road. As you can see on the stage three, when we receive the audit, the drawings, we told them, hey, what is this that you are putting in here? Oh no, it's a beautiful landscape. Seriously, for me it's a big stone, it's a rock, more than 400 tons. I don't know, but are you going to pay to put a stone? Yeah, 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 it's beautiful. We said, no, you are not going to put that one because that is a hazard. Okay, so what do you do? In the stage three, you make a comment saying, the auditors consider that this is going to be a problem. This should be removed. Because when you got a problem, a non-fungible problem, as I said, you got three options. Removal of the problem, relocation of the problem outside of the clear zone, or protection. These are the three things when the object is not fungible. If they put for me a rock that is made of, I don't know, of cartoon, perfect, no problem at all. But no, they wanted to put a real one. So we put that comment, oh yeah, yeah, no problem. We will take that into consideration. Of course, they took that into consideration and they brought the same one, no, and a similar one with the same kind of things that they wanted to put, and they put it. So when we did the stage four, we found our beautiful rock and it's still there. And I don't know, I think I will die and the rock will stay because the rock lasts forever, okay? So this is the kind of things that we realize there is no protection. There is nothing in there that tell us that you cannot crash. Oh yeah, but this is a 50 kilometers per hour road. According to the standards that we are having in here, when you are traveling at 50 kilometers per hour, your clear zone should be 5 meters. Anything that is within those 5 meters should be fungible. If it's not fungible, as I said, removing, relocation, or protection. You should protect that one. Nobody has done it. Okay, let's continue. No problem at all. This is the other side. In the median, we got the big rocks. On the other side, we got the lamp poles and the palms. Okay, well, that's it. Exactly the same kind of consideration that we have seen before. Why a designer cannot realize that, yes, beauty is beauty, but safety is safety. What do you prefer? Be beautiful and dead, or be a little bit not as beautiful like that and still alive? Think about that, okay? Again, another collector road. Okay, this one, we have a lane that is coming to an end and is coming to the main road that we got in here. And on the right-hand side of the picture, you can also see a cycle path that is nearly indistinctive because they were using the same color than the paving. I have seen at the beginning in here people driving, not bicycles, okay? Not bicycle, cars driving in there, okay? So they were coming from here and overtaking whatever, and they were coming pong and pong. So in here, we got the same comments that we have said before. First thing, the alignment is too straight to make the people go at 60 kilometers per hour. You cannot make this alignment and put a 60. It's impossible. You are telling them, like when I'm going and I open the refrigerator and I see a lot of hands showing me chocolate. Take the chocolate and say, no, no, I'm on diet, and I close the refrigerator. No way, come on. You will take the chocolate. But in here is the same. You're showing them a fantastic new route that is super straight alignment, and you're saying, no, 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 go to 60 because you are a good boy. Go to 60, you are a good girl. Come on. Not everybody has the qualities to go to 60 and refrain the impulse that they are going to have. Another thing that we got is the incorporation of this one. Do you see that the kicker arrow is allocated just at the end? That they don't give time to change the transition that they should be in here should be longer for a 60 kilometers per hour. Okay, so this transition is not done properly. Another thing is the confusion that people they had at the beginning, because when you are accessing to the cycle lane, to the cycle path, you got a drop curb. Well, some cars, they were using that drug care to access directly. They were confused. Same color in the cycle way is a mistake because the people, they will be confused, okay? Of course, as I said before, we got the risk of the lamp poles in the middle that you can have a collision, a severe collision at 40 kilometers per hour or more, or even crossing the curb and go and has a head-on collision, okay? These are our findings. When we see all of these kind of things, and all of these, they were different projects, okay? We say, okay, we got a problem with lamp poles. They are non-frangible, okay? Well, make them frangible or relocate them, protect them, remove it, relocate it, or protect them, okay? With adequate VRS system, vehicle restraint system, or high containment curve, depending the high containment curve, if you don't go over 80 kilometers per hour, okay? You got the hazard landscaping, remember the rock, okay? Relocate or protect, because that is not something that you should have in there. Consider the frangible furniture. If they are frangible, you can sleep during the night. That's not going to be a problem, okay? But you need to use these kind of things from the very first moment that you are designing it, okay? I know that there are designers that they are listening to me, and they're going to tell me, no, no, no. I'm not going to be using frangible because it's very expensive. That is an urban legend, I promise you, okay? It's because you don't want that the contractor, you want that the contractor get rid of all the things that he has bought already when the prices, they were low, and this is why you are not using the frangible ones, okay? Because the price at the end, if you buy the same kind of amount that you buy for other kind of lamp poles that they are not frangible, the price will be reduced, okay? And of course, you got the vehicle restraint system, the common barriers that you have seen everywhere, steel or concrete, whatever you need, and the high containment curve, like the 3F curve, okay? That can be another good option. It has been a very nice surprise for me when I returned to Qatar just a couple of months ago that I returned, that I have seen 3F curve everywhere where it's required and it can be used. So I'm super happy that they are following that kind of design. You know, I'm very happy with that kind of things. And you can see that they are not as intrusive as if you put the VRS everywhere, okay? Okay, let's see how we protect hazard, the thing that we have seen before, the collision at 40 kilometers per hour with a roadside object that is not frangible. But now let's check the lack of VRS or the lack of 3F curve, okay? We need to calculate the first thing is the level of containment that is required on the road, okay? At the location of the hazard. Okay, the level of containment is something that every single VRS is going to be tested, okay? And they will tell you, this barrier is going to be, if we're talking about the mass, okay? We can see test level 1 to 6, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Or if we are talking about the EN1317, it's going to be level of containment normal, N1, N2, or high containment, H2, H3, or very high containment, H4A, H4B, okay? So knowing that, these are the level of containments that our barriers they are going to have. But we need to know what is the level of containment that we require. And that is something that the people, they don't consider, they don't calculate, because a lot of them, they don't know how to do it. At the beginning, I had a manual from Colombia that it was fantastic, and they were giving you all the decision maker, you know, in order to know how to calculate the level of containment on the road. But now, last year, in 2020, the IRIS guys, following the European standard, the updated 2019/1936, they created a new manual, okay, for their standard, where they explain you exactly how to calculate the level of containment, knowing the volume of traffic that you got, the volume of heavy traffic that you got, and the speed limit that you need to have in there. And with those three factors, you can assess what is the level of containment that you must put on the road, okay? In here, we had the EN002 that now is already superseded, that the absolute minimum requirement that you can have depending on the kind of road that you are having. If it's a motorway, you need to put in the median H2, in the roadside, depending if it's protecting a gantry or if it's protecting a cantilever. So this kind of things is stated in there. But that is something that is going through the standard. However, sometimes we need to assess something called departure from standards. And sometimes they want to reduce the level of containment because they say that there is, even the category of the road is this, the traffic that we got in there doesn't justify that we spend so much money. Of course, contractors, they will be always trying to save money. Okay, it's like that. We need to have also into consideration when we are having protection for this kind of hazard, the working width. Okay, so it's the lateral distance that the if someone crash against the barrier will move and will allow the vehicles to deflect again into the road. Okay, so that must be calculated and included in the design. Some designers, they don't put it. They just put safety barrier and they say W4. Okay, very good. And later you can find that they put for you the lamp poles at a distance higher than 1.3 meters, that is W4, okay? So have a look to the next picture that we're having. This is one of my favorite places in Doha. I used to call it the killer. And I said I used to call it the killer because in one side of the road is 80 kilometers per hour, the speed limit. On the other side is 100 kilometers per hour, okay? So you're coming outside of the tunnel and you got that in the middle of the road. And they told me, one of my friends that he was here when I left, he told me, Miguel, they fix it. So this one, they create like that. Can you see? They make like a little cage with concrete and they allocate a crash cushion in front of it. When I saw that one, I was super happy. Okay, because that's the way that they should do it from the beginning. But since I left Qatar until they created the solution, it has been like that. Okay, so when I saw this, I said, okay, that is fantastic. But my friend in here told me, Miguel, well, it's not so good because they haven't learned yet. And they show me that same problem, different kind of Qatar, different side of Doha. Cannot we understand that we need to learn from our mistakes, please? It's like that. If we don't learn, why are we here? Why do you need trainings? Just to go and sleep and justify that you are not working? How is that possible? You got that problem close to the Pearl, and now you got this problem in the airport road. Come on. Okay. In the next slide, this is why you need road safety auditors that they read the whole project. This bridge is beautiful. It's a marvelous thing, okay? Until you realize that the pillar that you got in the middle, there was no reading, there was no correlation or checking from the structure team to the road team when they were building that. So in that way, they create a protruding. Instead of changing the radii of the pillar that we got in there and allocate equivalent surface of steel in order to make it thinner, you know, they make the same kind of framework and we got that one. This picture is old, okay? This picture is old because you still don't see how many hits of vehicles you got in that particular point. In fact, it's so bad that the other day I passed by there first time and I saw that they have put like a reflective thing or something in there in order that the people there are aware that they don't have the full hard strip that it should be. How is that possible? That a new bridge like this, a fantastic, beautiful one, we got that. Who is controlling these kind of things? What kind of road safety auditor has reviewed this one, if any, because I don't think this kind of, yeah, I don't know how is this possible. And it's new, it's a new bridge, you can see. Okay, the protruding part. Okay, look at this, new construction of a motorway. I don't remember if it's the F ring road or the G ring road. I don't remember because after the C ring road, for me, the too many letters in the ABC. So look at this one. What I was saying, do you think that any car that crashing here is going to have the dedicated working with for them to deflect without that they can go in here? Do you realize that designer, they can put the kind of barrier that they put in there, but later they put in another drawing, in another layout, in another layer in AutoCAD, they put, oh yes, we need to put the poles every 25, every 30 meters, okay? And with that is enough. Well, it's not enough, clearly it's not enough. Oh, no. The contractor always promise you, no. We will put the lamp poles on site with our engineer in order that we can comply with the standard that they are required for the safety barrier. When they tell you that, you feel comfortable. When you go on site, you feel stupid, okay? Because you can see that they haven't done it anything about the things that they were promising you, okay? Look at this. You got a new road in here, okay? Another collector road that we got. And this is all the area that is going to be developed, okay? How can you leave this road 50, 60, let's say that, okay? The people, because of the alignment, is going over 80. How can you leave this high, that is 1.2 meters without any kind of protection? The curve that we got in there is not enough to protect the people that you can be distracted, you can have a punch, a tire explosion, you know? You lose control of your vehicle, you go there. Can you imagine what is going 1.2 meters down with your car at a 50 or 60 kilometers per hour? I'm saying, and I'm good, 50 or 60 kilometers per hour. Imagine if it's over that and roll over and flip your car in there. I don't think a lot of chances of surviving, okay? So these kind of things, they will tell you, no, but my project is only the road. Yes, but you are responsible to protect the people that they are coming from there. So if you don't want to put a BRS because it's intrusive, okay, put the tree of care that you know that is going to be working up to 80 kilometers per hour, okay? Look at this one. This one, these are the pools that we have in order to collect the water from the place when it's the drainage, okay? The compensating pools. Look. This is a ramp that is coming like that, okay? And you got in here your VRS. Where is this VRS going to deflect? The VRS is just allocated on top of this pool. How is this going to deflect in order that the people, they can go continuing here, okay? And again, on the other side, you got the other problem. This is the cycle path. So you got cycle path in here, and a pedestrian path in here, later you got the pool, okay? When the people, they see this, you see this is the same color than the one that we got in here, okay? The people is confused, and I have seen many, many times people driving in here in the cycle way, okay? Okay, look at this, another one. This is the other side. You remember the bend that we had before, that it was, the visibility was constrained for a wall. But this is the wall, okay? But look the way that the wall is starting here. So you want to go to the right-hand side, you lose control, and you're going to hit in here yourself. And also, these mini trees or bushes or whatever you want to call it, these are allocated in a very high and very distinctive place. Look at the height that you got in there. Look at this. Do you realize that you got the curb that is not protective, okay? And you got in here the lamp pole just in the vicinity of the road? All of this, all of those? This, you are going to love it. I'm going to stop one moment because this is, all of these are real cases. We come here to do a road safety audit of a new bridge that is going to be open. And we find this. Okay, the cars, they are coming from here. Look at this. This lamp poles is outside of the bridge, you see? Logical. Look at this where it is. I still don't understand. Why is that? Okay. Who had the brilliant idea? Are you telling me that you cannot put this outside in here, hanging or allocating another extra, you know, extra beam in order that you can hold that one? That you need to put it here? Where the vehicles they are going to travel and pass by less than a meter from them? Okay. So the thing that we have in here is the piers, that they are fully exposed and they don't have any protection. Please protect them. There are many ways to do it, okay? The lamp poles and the traffic sign that are exposed, you need to relocate them, okay, or to protect them with VRS or with high containment care, whatever is required, but do it, okay? Don't leave it exposed. Areas where the slope is less than 1 in 6 adjacent to the road, you should put a VRS. Okay, let's say 1 in 4. I'm going to say from 1 in 1, 1 in 2, 1 in 3, you must protect it. 1 in 4 is the minimum where the car can recover. 1 in 5, 1 in 6 is good. If you are talking about a motorway, 1 in 10, 1 in 12 is fantastic. Okay, that's not a problem. So it's going to be flat enough. Okay, and in this country, seriously, you are not in Spain. In Spain, we got hills and mountains everywhere, and we don't have the flat terrain that you got in here. So it's something that you can afford to do it, okay? The VRS and the high containment curves should be considered when we are relocating, or we need to start using frangible matters, frangible items, okay? And please identify this item as soon as possible and include it in the design, okay? Let's see another one. The vertical intrusion, okay? Well, it's very common to have that the designer failed to have into consideration the vertical intrusion. They can have into consideration the working width, but some of them, after the working width, they don't know what to do, and they forget the if it's a high vehicle, that the vehicle will do that with the load. And that vertical one is what we call the vertical intrusion. If we increase the level of containment of the barrier, for example, if you know that you got an H2, that the H2 is going to be 0.8 in height, and you want to go to H4A or H4B, you know that you need to raise the height in order to avoid to have or limit the vertical intrusion that you go for that one. Sorry, I have put in here H2, H4, but I'm talking TL5 is the same. There is equivalences between them, okay? So why I'm saying this one? Because what we can find is things like this, okay? That the people lose control and they got the vertical intrusion like that, okay? Well, this is our case in Doha. We got our concrete barrier, H2 in here, with a ramp and terminal that I will talk about that later on. And on the exit of the road, on the external part of the road, because if we are taking a bend and we lose control, the car, will it go to the external part of the bend or to the internal part of the bend? Well, normally to the external part of the bend, that is the normal way, centrifugal and centripetal forces, okay? That is the reason. So if you lose control and you go that way and you crash into the barrier that you got in here, your load will basculate and you need to have that into consideration because you can hit the pillars that you got in there, okay? Understood? Hopefully, yes. Exposed barrier and ramp end terminals, okay? The use of ramp end terminal is not desirable, okay? Because it's something that is going to launch your car or your vehicle as if it was a trampoline and your car can fly, okay? Of course, if you got like this one, this kind of beams that they are exposed, that means that you haven't flared it or you haven't put it with a crash cushion on top or a P4, no, it not require a crash cushion, it can be an attenuator, a P4, it would be okay. So it can cut inside the car as you can see in here, okay? So look at this, the way that they were starting, okay, in this way. Yes, you are going to tell me, oh, but the road was not open yet. No, sorry, was not finished yet. Yes, but the road was open in beneficial use. So why are we opening something that is unsafe? Okay, let's continue. Rampant terminals, I don't know. I think I'm showing you a collection of pictures, but I'm plenty of them, okay? So the way that they do it is they say, okay, I have my concrete barrier, let's start it anyway. And they said, ooh, if we put it straight, like a wall, like no rampant terminal, it's going to be bad. Let's put a rampant terminal that is going to be better. That is their thought. No, rampant terminal is as bad as the other, even worse, because in here, if one car that is traveling in here lose control and come from here and come in here, it will fly, okay? In here, what do you prefer? To have this kind of straight and hit the wall, or to have the rampant terminal and fly to heaven? You choose. None of them is adequate. Please, I hope my camera is working and you can see that I'm talking ironically, okay? Hopefully. Okay, look, even in a motorway, we got the rampant terminals heading the traffic, okay? That is not allowed. I don't mind if you have the rampant terminal at the end here. In here, if the traffic is in this direction, as we can see, you got at the end the rampant terminal, no problem. In here, you cannot have this one. Or you flare it that you got time and you can flare it like that, okay? Or you put in here a crash cushion to protect the beginning of the barrier, okay? Everywhere, we got the rampant terminals. You can see it's all around Doha, okay? Well, transitions between different systems, okay? Obviously, this transition is not very good, for not saying that is the biggest disaster I've ever seen. Well, it's not the biggest disaster because I have seen worse, okay? You can tell me, how can you see worse than that? Well, I will show you later on. So, as I said, the thing is that in the IAM that now is superseded, they used to say that you cannot use a rampant terminal unless certain condition. But now that is forgotten and we are in another way. So all the rampant terminals in Doha, as far as I know, they are trying to sort it out and no problem at all. We need to choose a correct way, a right way to end our barriers, okay? And there is a list, you know, where you can see different kind of end terminal transitions and crash cushion. Use it. Use the approved list of items that we got in Asgal to use it, okay? And of course, the designer must include in every single drawing a note indicating the level of containment that is required for the attenuator. I'm sick of seeing here that in a motorway, when we are 120 kilometers per hour, they put containment level TL3. That is not enough for that one. So you must find, you know, an adequate crash cushion for the speed that you're going to be working, okay? These are examples of tested devices, and this is the last one that I had in here. It was from February 2018. Hopefully, I haven't checked it yet in internet, but hopefully you will have an updated one with more lists of suppliers that they have been tested and approved here. And this is the one that I wanted to show. After this, we are going to have a little break. When I said that the join could be even worse than that. If you remember the two different systems that we saw before, it was the concrete and steel, and they were not linked or connected. But this is even worse. This is one project after the other with the same kind of supervision consultant, okay? And in here, they finish. One of the projects was finishing here, and the other in here. And that is the way, when I went there, that's the way that they were allocating the safety barrier. And I said that this is a joke, you cannot have that one. There must be an overlapping, you know, in every single safety barrier in order that they work properly, okay? So they called me after a week, Miguel, everything is sorted, no worries, come and do the audit for us. So I went. And I call these pictures the joke. It's not very funny, but you can see what they did. they extended a little bit just in order that they couldn't see that there was a gap. So of course I reported and I told them that this is not acceptable. Okay? Let's stop in here for a moment. Dr. Wild, you can take the control now if you don't mind, and later you pass it on to me. And because you wanted, I stop after 1 hour, okay? I can continue, but it's okay. No problem at all. Dr. Wild?
Miguel, I think you can continue. We said that without a break is fine because it's just a 2 hour. Usually we after 1 hour.
No, I don't have a problem. Perfect. Fantastic. Yes. Well, let me see because maybe I have lost control of this.
You lost control, yes.
You need to give me control again.
Yes, I will give you control. As we discussed, so now it is almost 6 p.m. So 45 minutes later to 50 minutes, we can stop for a 10 minutes, 15 minutes discussion, and then we move forward with ending decision.
Yeah, but this is quite hard for me because I'm not controlling anything yet.
So please, can you?
I got in here
faster because we have 50 minutes maybe.
Yeah, okay. Can you give me the control because it's not working yet?
1 second.
Yeah. Now? Yes, I got it. 1 moment. I'm going back. Down, 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 down. Okay.
Hello?
So let's continue. Yeah, I'm here.
Oh, can you hear me?
Let's continue. Yes, I can hear you very well.
Because I have to take again the control 1 minute, because I have to mute myself. I will mute myself first. Thank you.
Okay, no problem. Okay, let me see. Yes, let me put it in here. Okay. Okay, let's continue with the presentation. We are going to see another main problem that we have is merging, okay? Merging and diverging. That is very conflicting points that we got in there, okay? Because we can have maybe a T-bone collision, but in here it's not going to be T-bone. It's going to be a lateral crash, but it can be a very high speed, okay? And it can divert the people. They can crash in a way that the second line, they can have the T-bone collision, okay? So the merging with a sharp entry angle, okay, this is going to reduce the visibility for the drivers, okay? Taper is not a solution. Most of the things that they were designing when I was here, it was a taper merge, okay? Thanks God, they had changed in the new guidance too, okay? In the QSDA in 2015, the taper now, it was a departure, and now in the 2021, they still continue as a departure. So have a look to this one. In this visibility mode that I have put in here, picture, I'm trying to identify which are the areas where a driver can focus and see, okay? So you realize the green one is where you can have plenty of visibility and movement and everything. The yellow one, okay, is where you perceive just movement and a blur area because you are focusing the green one. And the red one is the place where they are completely invisible for you. So if the designer allocate the signs in a place where you cannot see them until it's too late, okay, it's the same that if they are invisible. Same kind of things we got for the driver visibility. There is a skew area that if we go into a junction and we go in 90 degrees, we have plenty of visibility. Or if we go at 70 degrees, we got plenty of visibility. But anything between 70 and 30 is going to be a conflictive angle, okay? So that kind of things we need to try to avoid, okay? So you will see that when we receive a drawing like this and we need to do the audit, and you put this kind of merging, we are absolutely recommending that this merging shouldn't be accepted. The merging should be with a angle that it should be like that, bringing our radio, our incorporation, our junction to 70 to 90 degrees in order that we gain the visibility. Later, Yes, of course. When we are having in here to do that, it's going to be very difficult. So the people, they say, no, we cannot change the design. What can we do here? And they always ask for mitigation, mitigation, mitigation. Come on, start solving the things from the design. You designers, if you know that this is going to be conflictive, go for this one. And they are going to tell you, yes, but I don't have the land to do it. There's going to be a problem with the neighbor because I cannot acquire. Come on, you don't have the land, you can buy. But of course, you don't want to spend more money. Third-party land is always available if you do it properly, okay? As I was saying, these are the manual that I'm going to update with the new one very soon. But if you cannot do it a full auxiliary lane, you know, for the merging, acceleration lane, you must put it, as I have put it in here, a 70 to 90 degrees, okay? The taper that we have in the bottom one is now a departure. You are not allowed to use this one unless that you got specific conditions to put it. But it you need to apply for a departure to put it before. So 70, 90 degrees, acceleration lane, fantastic, whatever is required. Taper, forget it. Okay? Same that in here. Before, you have seen the way that they were building the RADI when we are coming and do the filter for the traffic junctions, okay? Well, now, not anymore. You can see, if you got that RADI, it's because you are going to have an extended acceleration lane, but if you don't have that acceleration lane, you are coming there to 70 to 90 degrees. And I have seen that working very nicely now in Doha. There have been, you know, several arrangements in different junctions that before they were very bad, and now, in my limited time in here, I have seen the improvement. I'm super happy that this is happening. Now, look at the way that this is going to be done. Before, all these kind of filters that we got in here, they were coming like that and coming like that with a taper. And now, no, they have removed the taper and they're coming like that. Okay, 70 to 90 degrees. So very happy to see that one. And why I'm also very happy? Because in here, we are having consideration for the pedestrian. In the new rules that we have in the new QSDM, we consider the safety of the pedestrian the most important factor. Hallelujah. That is what we wanted to see as road safety auditors or road safety specialists, okay? It's too hard to see that the people, they are trying to walk in a city that is not for them, that it hasn't been designed or planned for them. But now we are already, hey, let's consider them. And I know that in the new one is even more. And now they are doing a lot of construction in here just to make it possible that you got cycle lanes and you got footpaths all around. And it's fantastic to see the evolution. And this evolution is not taking a lot of time. I can tell you that it's changing within 5 to 10 years maximum. It's incredible the changing that is happening in here. And that is good that it's happening, okay? Look, if you got an unsignalized crossing, okay, it shall be situated on a top of a raised top, okay? So they're telling you that no pedestrian is going to be unsafe crossing at grade in the filters that we have seen before. If it's not signalized, raise table like that, okay? But you don't put a raised table if you got 2 or 3 lines in the same direction. Okay, so this is why I was saying before that the filter should have only one lane, because if you got 2 lanes, you cannot put a raised table. Okay, good. And these are different kind of examples that we will have a right turn with the acceleration lane or a right turn with the 70 and 90 degrees that they are going to be allocating the zigzag lines that you got in there, indicating that you are going to have pedestrian crossing. Okay, some of them, like the top one, is signal control. Some of them, like the bottom one, they are not signalized, but they got the right table in there. Okay, so before I also told you about the straight alignment that we have, and we put 60 to 80 kilometers per hour in a straight alignment. Okay, so it's very difficult to comply with posted speed of 50 kilometers per hour in a dual three lanes carriageway. Okay, separated by a median, as we have seen before, or a dual, not 3 lanes, just dual, okay? So At 50 kilometers per hour, the police is not going to allocate any kind of enforcement, okay? It's going to be done when you go over 80 kilometers per hour. That is what they do. So for 50 kilometers per hour, you designers, don't give 3.65 meters for the width of your lanes. You don't need that in a collector road. Come on. You are putting a dual carriageway, reduce the width, okay? Reduce the operational speed, allocate traffic calming measure that they allow pedestrians to pass by, okay? So that is the kind of things that we need to have into consideration, okay? As I showed you this before, all these kind of things, look at the width that we go for the lanes in here, okay? Trap lanes, I talked about them before. So sometimes, very often, we got a particular movement that is obstructed, okay? And because of the traffic flow that you got in there, you are not able to escape and you are trapped in a lane, and later you need to continue doing a movement that is not your desire. Or on the other hand, is going to facilitate that you do a sudden maneuver, okay, a sudden lane changing, because you don't want to be in that lane that you are. So give enough space to do the weaving, okay? Yeah, but someone is going to tell me, but if I'm giving enough space to do the weaving, I'm going to put the junctions very separate and the pedestrian, they are not going to use it. Come on. In the middle is the virtue, okay? So that's the thing that you need to do. Trap lanes normally are denoted by dot lane markings, okay? And the family and the motorists, they are not familiar with that one. So you can see in here, trap lane, that when you are coming directly from this filter that we got in here, like that, if when you come in here, you don't realize that this is a trap lane, you will be ending in another turning to the right, okay? So this is the distance that you got between this junction and the other junction in order to do your weaving. But of course, if you got a lot of traffic that they are coming from these lanes, you're not going to be able to enter. This is why this kind of configuration of trap lanes is not going to allow you to change properly, and you got to do this kind of late movement, okay? Just like that. Designing for non-motorized user, or as we call now, vulnerable users, okay? But before it was called non-motorized user, okay? The common issues that we got, well, the common issues is that the footpath is the path for everybody and everything, okay? If you don't know where to put a sign, put it in the footpath. If you don't know where to put a bush for beautification, put it in the footpath. But can the pedestrian, they cannot pass? Don't worry, they will go to the paveway and they will walk in there, but put the things in the footpath, okay? So they also have lack of aligned flush drop curve. So you can find a drop curve in here and no alignment with the next one, okay? And normally we don't have any kind of light in several footpaths. Look at that, beautiful. I love these kind of things, you know? You have a palm that is growing very nicely. And in here, just imagine that I'm pushing a trolley with a baby, or I got a wheelchair, or even myself. You, I got a perfect body. I'm a little bit fat, but perfect body. I barely can pass from there, okay? So I will need to drop in here and going like that. Or why not? Why not? Why not? If you don't have palms, let's put a tree. And of course, in the space that we got remaining, we can put the lamppost. Yeah. Okay, no more comments. I think you understand this one very well. This is the kind of things that you designers, you must change, okay? It can be done. Look at this. If you know that the area that you are planifying is going to have any kind of administrative office, governmental office, is going to be in the proximity of a school, in the proximity of a hospital, okay? And you know that there is going to be demand of parking, please provide parking, okay? Because otherwise, the people that they are, as I said, very well educated and very good manners, they don't want to make congestion on the road, so the road is free, but they will park where the pedestrian needs to be walking, okay? So please attend the demand check the your demand, okay, what you need to do. In here, very easy, as I said, no drop curves. Drop curves, remember, is not just for the people that they are disabled, okay? Drop care is for everybody, even an old person, you know, that it has problems to walk and is walking slowly, but is walking by herself or by himself, okay? If they find that they got a ramp and a ramp that they can use, okay, they will use that one rather than use the step, okay? This using the curb. The same than if you are pushing a trolley or the if you are using the trolley with the how is it called? With the post, okay? With the post, the mail post, they use a trolley. Or if you are with a bicycle, okay? All of that is going to help the people moving, okay? Why do you put it? Why don't you put the drop curb? That's important, okay? Look, this was a bridge that it was connecting a residential area that it was in this side with a commercial area that it was in this way. Before, the pedestrians, they didn't have any way to cross. So some of them, they were coming here, they were jumping one fence. Later, they went into the motorway four lanes, stopping the median, jumping the median, another four lanes, and come back, and that's it. So you know that there was a desired line of crossing there. Only very brave people they were doing, or crazy people, not brave, crazy people, they were doing that. So what do we do? They open a junction there, but the junction, it was not for pedestrian, but it was communicating the area that it was residential with the area that it was commercial. And they didn't give any facility for pedestrian because that junction was not for pedestrian. Do you think that the pedestrian, they were going to say, oh, look, they have done a bridge for the cars only. It's safer if I'm going from there, but no, I'm not going to use it because it's for cars. Do you think that that is the way that they were thinking? Well, no, you can see the pedestrian start using that one, and we started to have a problem for people that they could be struck, you know, by cars during the night, because as you can see, they are not very distinguished when we are talking about them, okay? So just be aware that every single thing that we are doing on the road is going to have a lot of influence for you designers in order to have into consideration pedestrian or the vehicular. Maintenance, that's another thing. I haven't seen yet any project where they include the maintenance part. And that is paramount, okay? We need to consider the maintenance of everything that we are included in the project. Everything, okay? So this is why the utility covers, we should allocate it outside of the running lanes, not in the middle of runabouts as I have seen, okay? In order that we encourage an easy maintenance and minimize the amount of traffic management that we need to do when we are repairing or doing any maintenance, okay? The maintenance for landscaping, for beautiful things, should always be considered when we are allocating that one, especially when we talk about pruning, watering, or mowing, okay? For example, this one is very characteristic. Alvida Park, I think you know this, okay? Look, look, look well what you got in there. Let me do a zoom for you. Look the way that they are doing the maintenance. Okay. Well, you got two guys watering the plants, okay? And the third one that he should be looking at the traffic is looking at his mobile. But of course, this is not the way to do the work. They haven't even closed one lane. They don't have a TMA. What if this ladder falls down? Okay, you understand? So, this is what I wanted to show you from the place that I'm living and working now. But as you know, I have been in many places around the world. So now let me show you other places in the world. Let's see the good practice or bad practice, okay, that we got in here. For example, in Spain, we were talking about the end terminals of the barrier. Well, have a look. You got like that. And the only thing that they have done is to bend the barrier. And this is my own country. It's like that. Look at this one. Look at the ditch. It's not protected at all. Okay. Look at this one. Do you see this one? That is made of stone or concrete. If you fall down, you are going to have a problem in there. And there are ways to protect this one. And there are many of these in the local roads in Spain, many of them, okay? Do you remember when we saw that road in Doha that we have the palm trees and we have also the lamp poles? But in Spain, we don't have palm trees. We got trees and we have also lamp poles. So this is why you can have a heat in both, okay? So we are very similar, Qataris and Spanish. Same kind of problems, same kind of non-caring of the problems, okay? Some of them, they will tell you, protect with a barrier, and we do it. We protect our lamp poles with barrier, the latest technology in barriers. Seriously, this is like a joke, but this is real, okay? Just like that. Of course, I don't go, seriously, understand me very well. This is ironic, okay? I don't want that you say, no, no, Miguel in one presentation told me that I could put a circular barrier. To make the barrier like that is more difficult than to put it normal in the way that it should be put, okay? The one that has done this one, I don't know, or has a bigger sense of humor than me, or he was an artist, because that is difficult to do it, okay? Look, connection. Connection of the barriers. Same problems everywhere, okay? Look at this one. The length of need. Who has been calculating the length of need for this one? Don't you realize that they have flared, they have done the ramp and terminal, but we are just before a cliff, before a valley that we got in there, and we should be covering that one for people that they don't fall down? Okay. Remember the vertical intrusion? Look at the pillar where it is. Okay. Look at this. We got the sign and we got the other one, the one for the water in concrete, okay? But in here, we don't have the beautification the way that we have seen before in Alvida Park, but we got this one that we cover with our grass and no problem at all, our bush, okay? Different kind of connections, and they are not linked, any of them. Look at this. The barrier passed to the concrete like ta-chan, magic trick, and there is no connection at all. But the best part is we try to avoid the rampant terminals on the median. Have a look the way that we have done it. We put another two pieces of concrete that they are not linked to anything, okay? And we put it like that in order that we avoid the rampant terminal, because we know that the rampant terminal is bad. But if you don't connect it, if you don't do it proper work, everything is not going to be working, okay? Look at this. Don't you miss a crash cushion in there for late movement? Or don't you need in here delineators in order that they show you the way to negotiate that area? Okay? Or even the chevrons in there. Again, look the connection that we got in here. It's my country, eh? Remember, I was talking to Qatar, but now I'm talking about Spain. I will go later on to another one. Look at this connection that we got in here. I don't want to make a lot of emphasis in this kind of stuff, but you must know that a road safety auditor must have enough knowledge about everything that I'm saying here in order that they can illustrate designers, and designers should be listening to them. Because designer, listen, comply with the standard does not guarantee road safety, okay? Seriously, look at this one, maintenance. Look at the way that they are doing it. You realize the mess that we got in there? Two different kind of asphalt, a plastic barrier. Do you think that you have the exclusivity here in the Middle East about the plastic barriers? No, we got the same in Spain. And we treat it exactly the same. We don't put anything, we don't fill it with water, we don't do maintenance in there, like that, okay? Local road, trees. In here we have seen local roads, palms, okay? Another one, more connections that we got with ramp and terminal in there, and in here, no connection between the concrete and the steel, okay? Look at this, the piece that they have put in there to connect. How are you going to be connecting there? It seems that all the money that companies dedicate to investigate and to find what we call transitions between different kinds of barriers, that you can have it concrete to steel, you can have it steel to concrete, you can have it steel to steel, different manufacturer. All the money that they have invested and doing tests in order that they can create a safe transition for everybody, we don't care. Because if we have something like that, you put the beam, the steel one, until it reaches, and later you got the concrete one, and that's it, no problem. Don't you realize that if you hit in here, in this at this point, and the barrier deflect, when the barrier deflect, because it's not linking here, that barrier is going to guide you directly to the beginning of the concrete barrier. So it's guiding you to a trap, okay? So please, designers, don't put barrier up to here and later you can put the parapet for the bridge. No, you need to put the barrier up to here and you need to indicate also that there must be a transition, whatever measure it is, 12, 24 meters, 36 meters, whatever. And if you need to make that transition with more rigidity, you put it that, please, okay? This is why road safety audits, they can help to enhance safety from the very beginning, okay? Okay, all of these war zones in Spain, okay, if in here war zones they are a disaster, in Spain they are also a disaster, okay? We got the same kind of things. I know that I have seen someone from Valencia, but I'm not telling any lying in here, okay? So you can see, look at this one, war zone. Look at the way that they are protecting. They are working without any kind of protection, no TMA, nothing in there. The live traffic, you can see that those vehicles, they are apart. Okay, it's going to be, let's say that is 60. Let's put, I'm going to be good, 60. Those vehicles, they are less than 6 meters away. Okay. Let's talk about South America now, a little bit of South America. I'm not going to say the countries, but I'm going to tell you that these pictures are from different countries. Okay, look, people in a market, okay, and they are crossing everywhere. There is no delineation for them to cross in a safe manner. Okay, the pedestrians, they are all over the place. Look at this one. Look at the way that the pedestrian crossing is done. Okay, you got someone waiting here, very good, nicely for him. Well, of course, with the traffic that you need to cross, the line traffic that you got, 1, 2, 3, four lanes minimum to cross in a zebra crossing. And look at the pedestrian in here. You see this one? Okay. Why? Because they got this structure that they got in here, and now they cannot walk where they used to have the footpath in here before. Okay. And they haven't habilitated a normal footpath for them now. Okay. Look at this. We had that problem too. The problem in here, it was that we have 3 lanes, okay? This one, it was just to do a left turning, okay? And the other two, it was just to go to the front. What happened is that the people that they were in here, they didn't want to do the left turn. They were waiting in here because they were thinking, I'm faster than you, and I'm going to do this, and I'm going to be in front of you and I can go in my direction that is going like that. But I don't need to wait the whole queue that these 2 lanes they are having. I'm coming from the left, pretending that I'm going to the left, la, 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 la. And when I'm in here and it's green, because it's green for all of us, we do like that. Yeah, there's a very well-mannered people around the world, not only here, everywhere in the world. So what we suggest is this. Instead of having this configuration, have this configuration. So you increase and you give in 2 lanes the possibility to go. This one, it will go to the front, straight, and this one, it will go to the front and left. But you are removing the possibility of people queuing in this area just to cross in front of that and provoking an accident, okay? Okay, this is one of my favorite. In here, they were building a metro, okay? And in order that during the night, they could see this one, the fence that they have put anti-pedestrians, okay, that fence, because it's dark, it's a blue, a dark blue, they put these barrels. The barrels is very curious because everywhere in the world they use it. And here you got the blue barrels, the yellow barrels that they are used as if they were crash cushion. They got special powers. But in South America, they also use barrels and the color in there is orange. Okay, at least they say orange, reflective. No, orange painted, just like that. And they say, okay, I put this one and I was thinking, okay, it's, at least it's distinctive and they are going to keep the people out of the beginning of the work. However, when you look at the barrel, it's not a barrel that you would like to crash with. It's a barrel that is done and filled with concrete, okay? And I was thinking, don't they realize that putting this, they are putting traps every 20 meters? If you don't crash with the first one, you crash with the second one, or with the third one, or even with the fourth one, okay? So everyone, it was like that. And I was asking, but why do you put this? And they show me this. They got the plastic reflective one inside the construction site because if they put this one, the people, they were stealing it. Tata-chan. Like that. So instead of putting the one that they are designed to make your crash passive, you know, that you don't have any problem to crash with them. No, no, no. Because they are stealing, let's put a barrel of concrete. Let's see if they are able to steal it now. Come on. I think stealing a concrete barrel is going to be a little bit difficult. But this is why they do it. Okay? Very simple. But it's like that. This is the pedestrian crossing that we can have meanwhile they were building the metro. So the thing is that they put the barrel and you can see that woman that is barely passing by in between. And when I arrive in there, I ask, but why are you doing that? And they say, oh, because the small cars, the small motorbikes, the small tuk-tuk that we got in here, they use this one to do U-turns. I said, no way. It is. This is why they were putting that one, in order to provide a safe passage to pedestrian, understood, okay? It's not very safe, but at least no motorized vehicle was coming from there, okay? Later, we need to talk about the people that they are working in the construction site. When I saw this one, I was very impressed because I saw all of them with the PPEs, you know, in orange color. I said, look, it's the first country that I see that all the people, they are motivated and they are doing the proper work until I saw this gentleman. This gentleman that is in the cycle, let me zoom, he hasn't got a PPE. Okay, I was thinking, okay, no problem. So he was taking whatever it was required. Saying that I have said many times that the construction site, they should be isolated, okay, for the general public, okay? But no, this one, this gentleman here, he's using the mobile in the middle of the construction site, just like that. Just looking what is happening in there using his mobile. Okay, with no PPE. As I said, pedestrian, because they don't have a defined crossing way, they are coming in hordes. You know, they are coming all like a troop. When they don't have any traffic, they cross all at the same time. Residential way on that area, a complex for sport, a sport complex on the other area. So you can see that children, families, full families, they are crossing from one side to the other a two lanes road in each direction. Okay. Well, they also have runabouts in there. Okay. And they also have problems to understand how the runabouts work. You can see that one of them has been born in the UK. Quite sure about that. Okay. Because you cannot have a runabout that kind of conflict. The problem is that in there, the people, when they are doing this, as soon as they see a little of asphalt that is free, they go there. There is not a lot of enforcement from the police, okay? So that is something that can lead in very, very big problems, okay? The same that we have seen before is about the debris that we are having from construction places and also the barrels that we got. Look, it's not just in the construction place that I showed you earlier. In the middle of the road that we have before, with buses that they are passing close by, you got also the same kind of barrels that we have seen earlier. And look, if they are doing any kind of construction, that is the way that they allocate the rubbish, you know, the debris, okay? This one that you got in here is a ramp, okay? Look, you will see later on the angle that you got for that ramp, the slope that you got. Let's focus in this lady trying to cross, okay? Let's see the stages that she's following. First, she stops. She's searching. She's looking for a place to cross. So she decided instead of crossing in the direction that she wants, she's crossing in this other direction that is going to be less dangerous because you don't have any traffic coming from there. But when you are in there, she is thinking, okay, I want to go in the other direction. So she is approaching to the footpath in there, and look at the criminal curve that we got in there. Do you see the height of that one? Can you imagine anybody taking their family or their little children with the trolley to push that up? Can you imagine if you are in a wheelchair? How will you do that? Do you realize? Okay, good. If you are working, don't allow the people to enter in your construction site. That is a construction site, and the people, they don't have any other way to access to their homes like that. The thing that you can see here, they are manholes. You can see that they are lying now the sub base of the asphalt. This is another manhole. And look at the way that this car is negotiating all the obstacles. Okay? And pedestrian passing by everywhere, of course. This is genius. This is genius. Okay? This is the way that the minibus or the minivans, they collect people to go from one side to the other. Okay? So me as an auditor, I needed to know because I was auditing the vicinity of the construction site that you got in there. So I saw this one and I asked, what is this person doing? And they told me, you will see, you will see. Okay. This is the kind of things that when they are passing by and they want to catch people, they start saying, I'm going to lurigancho, 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 lurigancho. So the people that they go to Lurigancho, to San Juan de Lurigancho, they will go there and they will jump inside. So they minimize the time that they need to stop. Sometimes don't even stop, okay? But this minimizing, boom, and continue. So the person that is hanging in there, she's not aware about the huge risk that she's having if that driver makes a sudden movement or lose control, okay? So this kind of stuff, I was asking them, okay, why don't you create a bus stop or a van stop in order that they can enter? And they tell me, they told me in that time that they are working continuously, not stopping the car just to put petrol only, because according to the number of trips that they do, is the money that they are going to be receiving for their employer. Okay? So just like that. Of course, if you realize, look at the lamp poles that you got in the vicinity of the road. Okay? Good. That is a ramp. Okay, just imagine that you don't have that under a battlefield. That is not a construction site, okay? But have a look to the permanent footpath that we got in here. This is a ramp, okay? This is the normal height that we have for the curb. Who needs 3F curb in here? Do you realize the height that they got? You are protected because you are behind a wall. But look at the ramp that you got. It's nearly 45 degrees. How are you going to be a disabled person to go and negotiate that ramp? Okay? Just forget about this, that of course, nobody in a wheelchair can negotiate this. But imagine that everything was asphalt. How are you going to do this? So people, they know that they should habilitate special places for disabled people, for people that they got the, but they don't know how to do that properly. They don't have standards that show that, okay? Fortunately, this is changing, okay? This is evolving, but it's taking time. I always say, why do you need to reinvent the wheel? Take the standard from any country that is a neighbor from yourself, copy-paste intelligently, okay? Apply whatever it has been already set up in other countries and is working, apply into your country, okay? And you don't need to invest millions just to bring another consultant from another developed country to tell you what you need to do. Because what he's going to do is to take the manuals that you got in other countries that they are more developed than you, that they are your neighbor, and he will copy intelligently. And you can do that by yourself, okay? Continue. Look at this. That is the footpath. That is the footpath, and also the storage place for the people that they are doing the construction of the metro, okay? So if we put the beams outside of our construction site because we don't have any place to put it inside because we need to continue doing our work, why you put it where the pedestrians they need to pass by? What happened with the pedestrian now? They don't care. Is that familiar to you? Do you realize? Pedestrians now here in Doha, they are having priorities. In Spain, they are having priorities for a long time now, but they were not implemented. And now in South America, they are having priorities, but it's taking too long. This is why when yesterday we were talking about the second decade of action, okay, and the target it was to reduce 50% the casualties, why the hell do we need to reduce again 50%? Why we're not able to do it in the first decade of action? Why didn't we take this seriously? Come on. What happened? The only thing that we take seriously is if Messi has a yellow card and he's going to have the red one. We know that rules and we pay more attention to football and this kind of things rather than to save the lives for the pandemic that we got with road safety, with the traffic injuries. Okay, look at this. That's the way that the beams, they were allocated. Look, you see, this one is the pedestrian that they should be able to walk anywhere in here because it's wide enough, nothing. They put that one and they didn't allow him to go properly. But look at this, work zones. All these signs, they should be reflective, okay? But they are not reflective, they are made of wood. And they are painted, okay? Why? Because the reflective one, they steal it and they sell it, okay? Look at this, they don't care. Maybe these are doing the construction site in Australia, you know, because they are upside down. This is very good. As I said, you remember when we were talking about maintenance and I show you beautification of Albida, they were watering and they wouldn't have the protection. The only protection that they have, it was the magic cones, okay? They were magic cones, okay? They were influencing you with a electromagnetic field rather than if you going to crash with the people, the magic cone put a special force and nothing is going to happen to you. But in South America, we don't have the magic cones, okay? But we got the magic, the magic barrier, the magic broom, okay? So you can give your back to the traffic and don't worry because your broom will be able to save you. Like if you were a witch, you step into the broom and you start flying, okay? Just like that. The people, they don't cover the construction material. So you can find, as I saw, stones coming down directly to other vehicles that they were traveling. Yeah, vehicles, maybe we are covered, but what happened with the motorbikes? Okay, what happened with the cyclist? Can you imagine if a rock hit a motorbike or a cyclist or even a pedestrian? Okay. After a while, I got millions of pictures like that. I can continue forever, but don't you think that you told me that you wanted 15 minutes in order that they raise questions to me?
I think since I cannot control my computer anyway, I could not check the questions. But so
no, you can go ahead. It's 15 minutes we got now.
Quickly, I prefer that you go quickly with this figure, with these pictures.
I cannot go.
I can
faster.
See many of them have a very clear message, so you can show them quickly for our colleagues and our participants. Also, it will be included in the video of the recording of this workshop.
Okay, very good. So pass me the leader again, please, and I will continue. I don't have a problem. Whoa, where is my presentation? Now. Okay, let me see. Yes, I got it. Let me go back here. Okay, this picture that we got in here is very lovely because you got this gentleman that he would like to cross, but to cross where? He got a pedestrian crossing that before it was guiding him to the other side of the road, but now the other side of the road is completely obstructed because we are building the metro in the middle. So what is this gentleman waiting for? Is he waiting for to use the pedestrian crossing to go where? To there? Maybe he wants to jump in there and see the construction, how is it going, okay? There is no drop curb, as I said before, okay? And look at the way that the stop line is allocated. Another problem that we had in here, it was the people that they were waiting to enter into the construction site. You can see that it's a road that it has two lanes, okay? But the big vehicles, the big trucks, they were doing a queue and they were realizing they were obstructing one of the lanes, okay? So that is something that the contractors, they must to have into consideration when they are doing the construction site. However, designers, they should put a plan, okay, about how this is going to be the people that they are bringing the material, when and how they are going to be stocking the material, okay? That is our duty. Look at the main difference in here. You got this kind of asphalt road that you got in here, and this is the road network that we got for local roads. Look, it's non-asphalt at all. So imagine to drive from here to there, the nightmare that it is. Okay? Okay, look at this. This is my friend Javier, and he is pointing the height of the curve that we got in here. Okay, look at that one. And this is the representative of the municipality, Felix. Okay, Felix Paucar. Another thing that I wanted to show you is, look, you got stairs in here. You got three steps to go down this huge curve, but they have put this kind of communication pole in the middle. This is not light pole. This is a telephone pole, okay? And look at that, it's in the middle of the three steps that you need to go down or go up. So are you sure, designer, that you didn't have any other place to put that one that needs to be there? Has anybody realized about, you know, just a topographical survey, just to make an appropriate, you know, distribution of the height that we got on the road, on the street? Okay. Look at this. That's the pole during the night. We wanted to show that we were doing also the site visit during the day and the night. So the pole's in the middle. Now you can see it. Okay. Oh, very good. When you got manholes that they are at risk, okay, that they are open, how are you going to sort it out? Well, we have already seen the magic broom. We have already seen the magic cones, the super powerful barrels, okay? But you haven't heard about the plastic mesh. The plastic mesh is even better than a Spider-Man web, okay? Spider-Man web is very sticky and saves you every single time. This is similar, but in red color and made of plastic. So if you got a manhole and you don't want that anybody goes inside, put the plastic red mesh. With that, you are protected. Seriously? We're in the 21st century and we're still doing things like that. Don't you realize that we got schools and children living in these areas? Schools and children and hospital or people that they cannot see, because you have seen that the illumination in here, it was negligent. It was very bad. So imagine to arrive to the corner in here, they are diverting the pedestrians from this side to come from here, you lose your foot and you go in there, like that. Okay, clear? Can we have a process for maintenance? Okay, can we have a process for dealing with these kind of things during the construction? Please? This is same pedestrian. Okay, and this is the way that they are giving to the pedestrians. Very smooth, clean, suitable for them, completely aside from the construction site that we got, isolated, giving them a safe environment that they can walk without any kind of worry. Okay, try to go there. My friend Javier did, you can see him walking. Okay. That's the situation. Can you imagine to pass this one if you need to have crutches? Okay, you are moving like that with crutches. I'm not putting now the disabled people. No, just crutches. I twisted my ankle and used the pair of crutches. Even for someone that hasn't got a problem, it's difficult to negotiate this area. Okay? And spears. So they are holding an advertisement, okay? And that is the best way to put it. Just let me show you where they are located. In here, you are going to have the advertisement in this area, in the middle, okay? But look, you got a ramp here. And in the opposite side in here, you have another ramp. So this is a passage, a safe passage for pedestrians that they are coming in this direction. Oh, maybe we have chosen the wrong place to allocate something to hold our advertisement. Maybe we should change it. Can you imagine this during the night? Can you? So I don't think that this is a very safe, as they indicate in here, that this is the way for the pedestrians. You see, it's very dirty, but you still can see the pedestrian sign in here. Okay, just cross straight with this in here. Okay, during the night, very good, eh? The visibility is fantastic. Okay, look at that. They're completely invisible. You cannot realize about those kind of things when you are crossing. And now imagine that you are crossing in the way that we cross many times. Not me, because I have already got an incident with this, but a lot of people, they cross looking at their mobiles. Okay? That they are like zombies. Oy, 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 oy. Okay? Well, just imagine if they collide with these kind of things. Okay? Please. Again, look, you got a deep excavation here, okay? But it's open, you can access, you can see, you can come here without any problem. And the pedestrian, they don't have any way to negotiate it, apart of go where the cars they are going to be, and they got a risk of being struck, okay? Very good. Look, this is the way that this should be design, you know, that is the best one that I found. But even in the best one that I found, because the contractor was building in this medium, okay, they didn't remove the curb that they got in here. Why remove it and later I need to reinstate it? Why to facilitate the pass to the pedestrians? You realize in here? And all these kind of things, these are the foundations for the fence that we got in here. So they put it like that. So this is really a trip hazard for them, for the pedestrian that we got. And this is the one that they are authorized. All of this like that. Okay?
Good.
During the night, same place. Do you realize now why I said that this curb should be removed and later reinstated? How can you see this one? You are worried about the foundations that you got in here, okay? But you are going to reach this point and you will not see it. Don't you see the shadows that we got in here? Okay, so pedestrians barely can see where they are moving, okay? This is something that it was very good, and that was a recommendation. They needed to have every 700 meters, every kilometer, an ambulance for evacuation just in case that something happened. Okay, so that was very good, and I wanted to put it. However, you got the ambulance. Everything is perfect. But why didn't you put a little ramp in here and select a space outside of the pedestrian area for the ambulance to be parked? Come on, you are doing something nice, something good. Do it properly. No, 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 no. The ambulance will be there. Okay? During the night, that was me showing, I think it was me, I don't remember, but it doesn't matter. That was someone showing the passage of another pedestrian.
Can you please finish 2 minutes? I'll be very thankful.
Okay, let me show this one and we finish with this one. Okay, look, this is me, okay? And this is a pedestrian ramp, okay? From ramp to ramp, and you got a big advertisement telling you, we are creating a space for you. We are building a city. But they are putting the advertisement wherever the pedestrian they need to cross. And this is not the problem. That is not the problem. The problem is what is behind that one. If you hit yourself in here, this is a steel beam, okay? So this is where I was crossing, okay? You come from here, you don't realize, and you hit yourself with a steel beam, the structure of the... You know that you need to go for 2.1 meters if you're in a pedestrian area, okay? My measure, my height is 1.8, okay? So this one is not even, is maybe 1.6 or less. Put it higher. Don't put it in the pedestrian route, okay? Look, the steel that we have in there. And Dr. Weil, I leave it in here and it's all yours.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Hopefully you enjoy.
So I think this was the last photo in the presentation. So thank you for all these experiences, examples that you are showing from different countries around the world, from Qatar.
Countries, to, yes.
South America, Latin America, and other countries.
Spain.
I have a lot of comments about people with disabilities. Normal people face a lot of problems. So how about people with disabilities? They look like they are absent from being considered in some countries. Are there any comments about that?
Yeah, good luck. It's like that. We need to change the mentality. They need to start treating.
Dear Miguel, I suggest you turn off the camera because your voice start cutting now.
You know, and that is a shame. Designer, they should start bringing facilities for people that they got problems with mobility. Okay, in order that they are in. Hello, El, can you hear me?
Yes, but the voice is cutting, I think. Can you please stop your camera?
Yes, if I cannot access now to my camera, I think, because I'm controlling still your screen. If you take, you become the host, that will not be a problem. I don't need to be the host anymore.
I will turn off your camera, it's okay, yes.
Yeah, but I don't need to see my thing. I would like to have access to my computer and see what is happening. To talk to the people.
Yes, please. You can go ahead.
Yes, I was saying that it's a shame that we still got designers that they don't take into consideration people that they got problems with mobility, or people that they got problems with vision, with the visibility. Not all of them, they need to be full blind, okay? Most of them, they are able to see shapes or to see colors or to see different kind of blur lines, okay? So we need to adapt, you know, and facilitate their life, you know? So far, I can tell you the environment of the city that I am now, it was not good for pedestrians, and it's going to be good because they are doing that kind of changes, okay? But in Latin America or in Spain or in many places that they have been, they don't have that into consideration. They still see them like someone that you need a special caring, okay? Mm-hmm. And it's not a special caring. They need the same kind of treatment for everybody, okay? But you need to be careful the way that you design things in order that they don't see themselves excluded, okay? Because they need to be with us. We need to create, facilitate their lives. That's the thing. And that is a culture. That is something that it will take time to be.
I have many questions about the cost effectiveness of treatments. Now, of course, there are so many treatments. There are very clear deficiencies on our road network, not only on, let's say, developing countries, but also in semi-developed countries and countries with, even if we go and look for many countries in Europe, even in Qatar, we can see a lot of deficiencies here and there in the road network. Now, how is there any way to do, what is your recommendation in terms of cost effectiveness, not only for the initial cost of implementation, but also for the maintenance cost, because all these additional systems, additional requirements that we can add, it requires maintenance and follow-up. So how this can be taken in consideration, considering the limited budget at the same time?
Yeah, of course, if we have unlimited budget, you don't need engineers. It's like that. With unlimited budget, you can do anything you want. Okay, but when you got a limited budget, all these kind of cost implications, you will realize that is convincing the politicians that a life is worthy and is more valuable than a death. Okay, tomorrow, when we talk about the economics in the road safety, we will see that there are different ways to calculate how much is going to be the value of a life. And you will convince the politicians saying, please, you just need to take to save two or three people that they are dying every year in this road. You start saving those lives and you will be saving money. I was considering, Dr. Wael, a very profitable way to sell myself. I wanted to start, it was a crazy idea, but just imagine. Let's start a consultancy. Imagine that I offer you, Dr. Wael, let's start a consultancy, you and me. Let's start doing auditing, and we are going to do road safety audit for free. And we are going to receive money for our job just after 3 years. So we need to start living from
Hello. Miguel? Hello, Miguel. Hello. I'm not sure, I cannot hear you.
Dr. Wael?
Yes, now your voice came. Before, your voice disappeared.
I don't know what happened. Okay. Now, the thing that I was saying is that within 3 years' time, if we receive the money from every single life that we save, okay, and you put an average of 1 million, 1.2 million in the rich countries, or 500,000 dollars for per person, you know, in the developing countries, man, we are going to be millionaire within 3 years' time. You don't need to do anything else. We are going to do that, and you say, okay, show me the road where we did our treatment. Yes, you used to have how many deaf people? They used to say, we used to have 50 people that they were dying every year. Okay, now, in the last 3 years, how many people you got? Okay, the first year we had 20. The second year we have 15. The third year we have 10. Okay, so how many lives have we saved? 48. Multiply by $500,000. Dr. Well, we can retire ourselves millionaire in 3 years. Think about that.
Yes, yes, absolutely right. Okay, I think we are already 5 minutes over the time today. I would like to thank you, really, Miguel, for the wonderful presentation, for a lot of information you have provided, and for all our colleagues and participants here. I would like to inform you about two things. First, regarding tomorrow's session is on time at 5 p.m. like today, and you can use the same link you had yesterday and you used today to access the same session tomorrow. At the same time, I would like also to inform you about the second International Traffic Safety Conference, which will be held in Doha. And this conference is co-organized with the International Road Federation and the World Conference Transport Research Society, as well as the International Association of Traffic and Safety Sciences, IATS. This conference is directed to road safety area, and it covers all areas from traffic to psychology to education to enforcement parts that relate to road safety. I welcome any of you to participate. This conference will be in 21 to 22nd of March 2022, will be in Doha, and it will be hybrid. So those who cannot attend can present online, and those who can attend are welcome to come to Doha. We have two tracks of submissions. We have a presentation only track, and we have a full paper submission where participants can submit full scientific papers and be considered for special journal issues in well-reputed journals. This information will be also circulated with you by email. We have all your emails since you registered to this training. And shortly, within a few days, we will send announcement about this conference. If you have any questions, also, you are welcome always to contact me and ask me about it. The last thing is the road safety audit questionnaire. For that, yesterday we had shared the questionnaire with all participants about road safety audits, and it helped us today to define what problems to concentrate on. And we really would like to ask those who did not fill the questionnaire to do it now. Those who already did it yesterday, we are very thankful to you all, and you don't need to fill it again. But those who did not do it yesterday, please do it with us now. I will share the link in the chat icon. Just give me 1 second, and I will immediately do that.
Just tell them the truth. Just tell them the truth. If they don't fill the questionnaire, tomorrow I don't talk. Just like that.
So the link is now in the chat bar. It will take only 2 to 3 minutes from you. Very general, very simple questions. It will learn us a lot about your perception and the situation in your country when we address road safety audits. If you answer it yesterday, you do not need to answer again. If you already did it, please do not answer it again. If you did not answer it last week, yesterday, please do it now. Otherwise, no need to do it again. No need to do it twice. I keep receiving these messages. I'm repeating it again. If you did it yesterday, please do not do it now. For only those who are joining us today for the first time, or those who could not do it yesterday. Thank you. By this, I think we can Thank you all, and for the nice journey of 2 hours today. I know that you have a lot of comments also and questions from our participants. We apologize for the technical issues and for the ability to collect all your information, all your questions. But again, this is not the only workshop. We have tomorrow session also, and we will repeat such kind of event of workshops online with different topics that also relate to road safety and audits in the near future. Thank you all. Thank you, Miguel, for your wonderful time, for giving us your efforts today. And wish you a wonderful evening or a wonderful day for those who are at the beginning of their day today. Thank you all. Have a wonderful day. And we will see you again or talk to you again tomorrow. Thank you, Miguel.
See you tomorrow, everybody. Take care. Bye for now. Bye-bye. Bye.